So let's look at then a text. And I don't know, did anyone here attend the ACTful talk that we gave just this past ACTful? Okay, so then this will be new to you, so this is good.
Yeah.
So in order to help you to start playing with this notion, we're going to give you a text by Hemingway. This is the beginning of a short story by Ernest Hemingway, and it's called The Gambler, the Nun, and the Radio. And it is actually an open text. It's in public domain. So what I'd like you to ask you to do is to read this text, and then looking at the various categories of the literary, the question that you should be asking yourself is there anything in this text that stands out as non-conventional, as creative, as different in some sense? Does it strike you as odd? Anything, right? Intentionally odd, right? Because obviously Hemingway wasn't by mistake, right? So, and then look through these categories of the literary and see how might you label what it is that you're sensing. Talk about it with your colleagues at your table and see what you come up with. And once you have an idea of what dimensions of the text may be literary in the sense that I'm using it, then maybe just briefly discuss some ideas about, how might you deal with that? What might be one way that you could start to put that into practice? Okay. Could we ask maybe just a quick reporting from each table, just some of what you were discussing, what are the flight categories that you would that you've identified, and how that ties into the text? Let's work with that first, and then we can also generate some ideas about your ideas about where one might go with this. So could we perhaps start at this table?
We were kind of like thinking about, like, first of all, I thought the Russian, it was the language in Russian or the person. I mean, that was kind of like an iffy part of it. So as first part of him, Nelson mentioned to me that they brought them. They, who are they? Kind of, question mark. So we thought it was very interesting, and it seems like to me was like wordplay, basically, kind of, showing in one word but means a couple different meaning, depending on who the reader's, point of view. So I thought it was very interesting in a way.
Okay, I looked at the visual play, for example, the everything is capital letters until midnight, and the second part of midnight is not capital. So to me, that was visual. And then sound, like all night long, everyone along. And then also when it says, in the thigh, I think, always going to die, I'm afraid. So thigh and die rhyme. So I didn't look what that sound play again. And then we also talked at our table about how the translator didn't translate cabron, which could mean that, for example, an accident that he hit me at all, the cabron, which could mean that even though the Mexican who was shot said he didn't know him, that maybe he did know him, okay? So, and we didn't look, I don't know which one that would talk about. So that's mainly what we talked about.
That could be code switching, perhaps, right?
And yes, code switching.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Culture play, actually.
Yes,
that would be culture play.
Mm-hmm.
So we talked about perspective specifically. Where is he shot? Mr. Fraser asked the night nurse. In the thigh, I think. What about the other one? And so you can get an idea that he might be talking about the two different people, but he might also be talking about the other thigh, depending on your perspective. also, the paragraph where it kind of explains what happened is could be different depending on your take of what happened, right?
Sorry, as far as I'm concerned, I think here that we have a grammar play because we have all night. It is night as a noun, but here it's used as an adjective because followed by a noun. And again, here we have paper said. Here we have metonymy. The paper doesn't, say something, but it is just like when you say the kettle is boiling. It's actually not the kettle, the water inside the kettle. And we have also, we have sir and senior. These are address use of different address forms. I don't know. Maybe at the beginning they were talking about the two men who have been shot, but at the end it was just a divergent in the. It was just an accident. So the mode of thinking has just changed. It's something else. I don't know. It was an accident, and talking about two men who have been killed, and then at the last, I say, you know, it's just an accident. So the ending was something unexpected for me. Okay.
I think we have another thing here. I feel that all the categories here we have in this, let's say, in this text, one of them was a symbolic play here using a goat to insult, and it sounds that he knows the person. And here we have to think about the meaning. Only the Mexican guy talk about or describe the shooting accident. Where's the Russian then? Yeah, so we have to, let's say, make our student think like that. And I don't know. Yeah, here we have like genre, because it's a kind of short story, and also we have narrative and descriptive. Here they narrate, and we can find here the quotation mark, which means direct speech. And then here we have, there were both workers and describing the, let's say, the situation. I believe again, not with the, let's say, the quotation with the, let's say. The quotation itself, now here with the description, and I think that's it.
Thank you. So we focused on the pragmatic play, perspective play, culture play, and word play. We were discussing the fact that there was something lost in translation there. So there's the perspective play. So the translator basically described something very short, very objective, but there was more to that in saying that I was an accident that he hit me at all, the cabrón, and it can have many implications, like many of you mentioned before, but there's more to that. Rachel, do you want to share your ideas?
Sure.
Rachel is the one.
We were talking about also, we focused on the end, and when we were talking about the pragmatic play, comparing the differences between the formal reported account in the newspaper versus the anecdotal account where the police officer and interpreter are talking to the Mexican. With the perspective play, talking about...
So we were also discussing what was the accident, the mere fact that he was shot, or the fact that he didn't move quickly enough, because maybe he shouldn't have been shot, and he was slow in moving, so he got shot. So we were discussing that.
I guess the other thing was the wordplay with accident. You know, is it an accident? Is something that you have no control over, but it doesn't seem like it's an accident because someone came in and was shooting at him. So playing with that as well, that's what we were going for. Yeah,
we were saying that it was written stylistically like a news report, but very confusing, and it was like boom, 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 almost like the shots that were fired, and it just. I don't know. Would you like to say something, Julie? I just, like, we got confused as far as, like, who was shot in the thigh and who was shot in the stomach. And then at the end, about the accident and how the whole kind of lost in translation thing happened with an accident that he hit me at all, the cabron. And then he said it was an accident. But yet it was, you know, how can it be an accident if it was... 8 shots that were fired.
Everyone along the corridor hear the Russian, and we don't feel or found the let's say the Russian speech here. What does this mean? And he said that I'm afraid that he, let's say, where is it? He is going to die, I'm afraid. Going to die, what does this mean then after having the conversation?
There is such a richness of play on so many different levels, and you've plugged into different aspects of play. The question then becomes, depending on the level of language class that you're teaching, because this is, after all, about language. We are language teachers, right? So If you are, for example, at the first year level and you wanted to use this in an ESL classroom, what is it that you're going to bring out about this text? How are you going to use this text in order to create a flight lesson? Are you going to talk about all of the things that we've just talked about? That wouldn't be useful, right? So what is it that you, where can you go with this text? You're feeling, wow, there's all the stuff going on. This is really great. Is it useful? How do you make it useful? What do you focus on? So any thoughts on where you might go with this text? Because the flight project for me was really about bringing notions of the literary language play to the very beginning. Because it's something that, yes, at advanced levels, we do. Not necessarily in the same vein, but we ultimately end up addressing these things in some fashion. But my first question is, how do we do this from the start?
I think you could maybe look at the use of pronouns here, how they use like they, he, him, right? Because I think that plays a lot into how you would interpret the story.
Mm-hmm. So pronouns, uh-huh.
For an ESL student, this would be really confusing. You'd have to talk a lot about perspective, from which perspective, who was talking about the accident, and then go into double meanings, you know, like where is he shot? Things. That's mm-hmm. good.
So I would incorporate a lexicon exercise. So probably choose several words and provide them with meanings, and they have to choose which one they think it's being used here, and they need to explain why, and piece together the story at a plot level.
As far as explaining why at the beginning level, that might be difficult.
Okay.
Yeah? Maybe?
It could, yeah, maybe.
Okay.
For later.
Mm-hmm. So someone mentioned pronouns earlier. So pronouns are part of how we refer. What other aspects of language are used for referring? Since a lot of people say that it's confusing, who's speaking, how, you know, what's going on? How do we parse? How do we make sense? And what language is being used to do that?
Yeah. Also, we can ask students to, let's say, arrange the events of the story, short story,
okay,
according to the time order.
So what would you need to do in order to, what is the sequence, and what would you need to do to change that sequence?
Yeah, for example, the first two lines, it's now. And then, let's say, the speech between quotations is the active conversation between between the nurse and the person who asked about the accident. So here we have different kind of genera. And also we can ask about, let's say, why we use such kind of tenses in this part of text and that part.
OK, let's talk about tense. What tense is being used through?
Present, past.
OK.
Yeah, and direct and indirect speech. So grammar, we can.
So what is the literal sequence? Not the sequence as it's present here. What was the sequence of events? What happened?
They are in the hospital, and everyone can hear their sound. They are
okay. But what was the sequence in real?
First, they were in the cafe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And what happened?
Then somebody came in.
Yeah,
started shooting. Yeah. One dove under the table. And then they magically appeared at the hospital. Yeah.
Okay, so we don't have the transfer to the hospital, but we understand. How do you know it's a hospital?
Because there's a night nurse.
There's a night nurse, and what else? And the corridor.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they brought them in around midnight. Mm-hmm. And then all night long, everyone along the corridor heard the Russian. So what is Hemingway getting us to do here? We have to reconstruct, right? So he's giving us references that we then have to fill in the blanks for. But we can do that, especially, let's say, as native users of the language or people who have that level. We do that without even thinking about it. Or we may feel frustrated and say, well, I have to read this a couple of times in order to do it. But in fact, we end up, normally speaking, with that mental image, with that understanding of what is going on.
I think you would need to do some pre-reading strategies, because if we had a hard time and we had to reread it a couple times because it was confusing to us, a non-native speaker would have even a more difficult time creating the image in their head. So if we did some anticipatory strategies, pre-reading strategies to help them, to give them an idea, create sort of the situation in their head, so when they started reading, they would have already an idea.
Okay.
Oh, and also, I love grammar, so the direct speech, once we'd read it and talked about it, I would have them put the direct speech into indirect speech to show the difference between direct and indirect speech.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We can ask them also to reconstruct the story. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and at this time they can get benefit from the grammar they use in the text. And also if they feel that something is missing, they can add. So at this time we have also creative writing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and focus on the grammar and on the ideas also, not only on the, let's say, the mm-hmm. language itself.
Okay.
We could ask the student to create a list of characters so that they have a framework to move forward on figuring out what's going on. But first we need to know who's here.
Right. Who's doing what to whom. Chantelle and I both created flight lessons for this text. I created one that I could use potentially at the second semester level, college level, what I would think of as advanced beginner. Second semester level for romance studies because of the number of cognates that are in romance studies and its relationship with English. When it comes to written text, you can actually go further, perhaps more quickly than you can with languages that have different writing systems and may involve. I mean, my undergraduate major was Chinese, so I know that it's difficult to get to that quickly, for example. But I want you to think about levels of the languages that you teach. The other thing to keep in mind is that when we talk about flight lessons, and this is a question, right? Do you do everything in the target language? How much English do you incorporate? From my perspective, my feeling is that in order to get where I really want students to go, I'm fine with using English as the language of instruction, especially for reading, right, at the lower levels. And what I've experienced in using this approach is that the benefit far outweighs that feeling of, oh, but I'm supposed to be doing everything in an immersion style. So if you're in an immersion style program, this could potentially create a conflict for you, for you to come to your own understanding of what that means and what the longer term benefits are. So in any case, when we come back from the break, you'll get a chance to see an introductory level and then an intermediate to advanced level lesson for this Hemingway text. All right. So the goal now for the next 45 minutes until 11 is we're going to give you, as I mentioned, two example flight lessons for this Hemingway text. So you'll read, then take some time in your group to discuss what sort of flight principles are you seeing coming out, how is it being manifested, comments, questions, etc. And then we'll bring it back to the whole group to share reactions, thoughts, and questions, right? So that we can go even further. All righty, perhaps we can stop you in your cogitations at this point. And again, I'd like to maybe just get some reporting from each group on what your discoveries are, your comments, your questions, and then we'll end with a fuller discussion of with our input included into helping to lead us into the afternoon session. So, is there a group perhaps that would like to begin with your reporting? What is it that you found?
One of the things that we talked about, the last thing we talked about was the fact that these kinds of lessons are very in keeping with current movements in teaching foreign language in order to teach students in a proficiency-based way, and encouraging proficiency rather than memorization of rules and things like that. And it's not explicitly structured in that way, but it is very definitely has that spirit, which is something that's very handy, I suppose, because that's how I'm now expected to teach and how I think I should be teaching as well.
That's right. Thank you, yes, for making that point.
Well, one other thing to add, which is really obvious, but I'm just going to phrase it. There's very good scaffolding planned. The levels are planned in such a way, the first one, for example, that you really have to establish the plot in a very basic way so that you can start analyzing. And that's done at both levels.
Right, right. Right.
I'm not completely clear on is the problem always when you want to use like authentic materials, you know? A lot of times, you know, you're kind of confused, you know, if you're making your point, this is too hard, you know, how to adjust to the level of the students. And in this case particularly, I was just like trying to make sense of the using a story by Hemingway, you know, with all the problems with vocabulary, you know, and gender and a lot of other stuff, for teaching something as articles. You know, I mean, I'm not sure, you know, if learning, you know, that needs to differentiate between indefinite and definite articles could get much of this story, you know?
This is not how I would introduce those forms. So I think one of the considerations is what are the resources that the students have? And another group, past tense, also came up, right? This is not how I wouldn't say, now we're going to learn past tense, here's a text by Hemingway, right? But if past tense is something that we've been working on in other ways, or if the article system or other forms of reference were something that we're working on, this is a way to build upon that so that students can see that this is something that doesn't just follow a kind of rule-bound set of paradigms, but it's something that can be played with, something that carries meaning in different ways, something that has kind of a lot of nuance in a sense. So it's expansive in that regard, but I think one of the considerations is always, what are the resources my students have? Which ones are they very comfortable with? Which ones are fairly new? What do they not have? And that's that question of how you scaffold them into the lesson.
And so just to clarify, for example, sometimes you study something, I don't know, for example, the basic things, you know, precisely articles, adjectives, you know, present tense, you know, in 101. And then you go over that again, you know, in 131, for example, you know, and then I think you could use something like. Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think Joanna framed this as late beginner, because the very fact that you're using past tense and narration means that you're probably not in your first year in high school, honestly, right? So for this particular text, which isn't to say we can't do this approach with those with the very early beginners. We're talking about other kinds of texts that might lend themselves to this. So this is late beginner, I think, is how you framed it. They have to be able to narrate a little bit, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Let me also just make clear, and it addresses your question. So this turns into a textbook, right? My approach developed into a textbook. But it is a complement to, it's sort of the reading-writing complement to the French textbook here at UT, Français Interactif, which has the embedded grammar syllabus, which has all of the things that an introductory-level textbook has. What I wanted to do was to go further. So in that first semester, they're introduced to these things, et cetera. And in the second semester, when they're coming back to them and they're starting to use them, what I found is that in Français Interactif, just like all textbooks that I know of, they didn't bring in this notion of language play, even with grammar. And for me, getting a sense of the grammar system initially may feel overwhelming, right? But ultimately gives students, and I worked with ESL students for years who were coming, we're just having this conversation. So languages that don't have an article system, like Arabic, doesn't have an article system, like all of the Asian languages. And those students were just throwing articles at nouns. I mean, they just, you know, trying to follow rules just didn't bring them anywhere. So once I started getting them working with the article system and nouns not as either or, you know, count or non-count, et cetera, they gained, because that is the goal, right? We want our students to be able to gain agency over language learning. And what I discovered is that, and found over time, is that it gave them a much better handle. But some of your goals have to be a little bit longer term. It's not going to be, oh, here's this lesson on the article system, boom, end of story, right? No, it's this developing that system and working with that system.
Can I add one just little thing to that? That's to flag something, and because part of what I hear you saying is, well, where what does this look like in a curriculum, right? Where does this fit in? And I think tomorrow when we talk about some examples from assessments, there we're having to turn our attention to how does this fit with the course objectives. And even though we're not going to show you a whole course, I think it'll become a little more clear in those examples how these might intersect with other aspects of a curriculum. Because I can talk a little bit about, and you can talk a little bit about how those examples we've brought in fit into our individual courses.
Right. And you can see it if you have time another later or whatever, is if you look at the website for Français Interactif and you just look at the core outline of the chapters, what the grammar topics are, and you flip through this book, you can see how it takes what is given in that introductory textbook and brings it to a different level. So it gives you a sense of the curricular arc.
What I have them do is that I'm not going to teach right away the grammar. What I do is I have them pull from the text and usually use graphic organizers and then compare and then work back to, like, for example, in the story, you have the present and the past. Mm-hmm. You know, you can find the keywords that were telling you this happened yesterday, this happened today. Then you can connect your tense and you can have them pull. But I like to have them work it out themselves. And then I'll tell them, okay, this is past tense or this is present. And I don't just come and say, I'm going to teach you the past today.
Right.
You know, it makes more sense
right,
to work in reverse.
Yeah,
and graphic of organizers for the content, the who, what, when really helps them to understand the story. So I use that a lot.
Right. I have never seen another example of the use of articles and that meaning of definiteness, indefiniteness to make a temporal shift. I've never seen that anywhere else. And when I read this text years ago, it just was like, whoa, okay. How does Hemingway achieve a temporal shift? So instead of, as I mentioned in that first lesson, going from a simple past or the preterite to then normally you'd have to go into the past perfect to understand, oh, this happened earlier, because he's not doing sequence in how it actually unfolds. So instead of, because Hemingway his whole thing was about minimalism of language. He didn't want to use complex tenses. We were having that question about tenses. So it's all flat in that respect. It's all preterite. How do you get a temporal shift? Oh, he starts with definite articles, makes us try to piece together the context, shifts to indefinite. Oh, this is when we didn't know who these characters were. This is the backstory. This is the temporal shift. So in order to understand that, you have to understand what definite means and indefinite means. We use these terms indiscriminately in textbooks. Oh, definite, indefinite. Well, how do we know something? When is something not known, when it's not shared? And what are all the different ways? That's what the article system helps us to play with.
Can I add something to
yeah.
that? And this goes back to the question of level and of scaffolding, which is something we're going to explore more in the afternoon, right? How do you set these up and how do you set them up for different levels? And part of what we wanted to do was take the same text and show you how it could work differently at different levels, right? Depending on what your objectives are, depending on what the students have as resources. And I know one of the examples for an activity that a couple people listed earlier was a recount, right? For me, a recount, that's intermediate advanced, because you have to have a lot of linguistic resources to do a recount. So if you ask the students, retell the story, they need to have not only past tenses, but temporal expressions, causal expressions. They have to have a lot of mastery over the language. But using a graphic organizer, right, where you're saying who, what, when, right, that breaks it down. Something else I've done with texts like this and workshops I've done with a different Hemingway text is to literally cut the text apart into strips and tell the students, put the story back together. They don't need a lot of language mastery to do that. They just need to be able to kind of play with it. And then they can compare the different versions with this one. Presumably, I haven't done it with this one, I've done it with a similar one, but I'm guessing a lot of people would start with they were both beat workers, right? You start
of course,
with the
yeah.
who, what, when. So then when they see the original version, they can say, oh, what's the effect of holding that off? This kind of feeling of confusion people had. They can also play with the questions, right? If you have a where question, where is he shot, in the thigh is gonna make sense, but he's going to die, I'm afraid, might be an odd answer. I mean, it's not implausible, but it's an odd kind of answer. So then getting them to see, okay, what are you noticing there about the language and the way you put the story back together is something a late beginner can do without having to have all that linguistic mastery of a recount, right? So thinking about where are they at and how can I support them is a really important question
right.
for this.
And that discussion would be potentially in English if it's at that first level, because clearly in order to get the fruit of that inquiry, you're it's okay to use English, at least in my world.
A lot of the students I've taught for a while now, they don't have any concept in English of what a definite article
that's right.
is, a noun, that's an
exactly,
adjective.
That's
and
exactly
so
the point.
You're teaching your language, and then you're noticing, my gosh, they don't even know what I'm talking about in their own language. So what you have to do, you have to, I take care of my business.
Right.
And then I reinforce for the English class also, which down the road, you know, is helpful to them.
Exactly. I was of a generation long ago where I only encountered grammar for the first time in high school when I started studying French. And I thought, oh, this is odd. Mm-hmm. 40 years later, students still have the same problem. They don't teach it. So we were talking about interdisciplinarity. Your approach to a foreign language really needs to intersect with what students are doing in English, because English for native speakers means literature, ultimately, right? So some of you may have responded to, there was a comment about, oh, the terms in the more advanced level would be something that in a high school level might be difficult to go into that level of specificity for terminology. And yet, this is about understanding how language works, and it's also something that contributes to their understanding of English and any other foreign language that they may potentially encounter. So FLLITE is also really about helping students to understand how languages work. Developing those intuitions, developing what kind of questions that they need to ask when they encounter something. It's not just this, you know, yes, no, black and white, oh, here's the rule, doesn't fit the rule, well, okay, I don't know what to do with it, right?
For me, I'm having a lot of tension right now, like I'm having my brain is talking to each
yes.
other or something.
Which is ultimately good.
Because there is this sense of, and I kept hearing myself during the activity saying, this is too hard, this is too hard, this is too hard, and so I think it's this anxiety of being an English language learner myself. And the protective thing that goes on with us as teachers and not allowing the play, because you keep saying the play. And you know, as a parent, it's not about language, it's the culture part that plays in, because as a parent, I'm married to a Jewish American man. He started playing with my children when they were little. And I'm like, what are you doing? We're the parents, we don't play. Because as a Latina, my parents never played with
that's
me.
That's right.
So I learned parenting in a different way. And I attribute that to the way that I protect my students from learning English, because I want to front load with a lot of prior knowledge and vocabulary and anchor charts and cognates when I just need to give them the text, right? So they can build their own intuitive approach, right? And play. So I think I'm having like a series of struggles in my whole body about what we're experiencing.
Yeah.
And maybe it's just me. But
no, it's not just you. I mean, this is asking you to open yourselves up to different ways, right? And that may be something that you ultimately won't want to do, right? But you also need to sort of think, okay, well, here are my students, what can, you all said in the beginning, I'm here because I want to get a sense of what I might be able to do to help my students, right? Well, maybe this is something, maybe it won't be the full approach that you'll adopt, but maybe sometimes you will bring that in as one of the many tools that you have at your disposal for helping your students to achieve different goals. And again, because we don't have the reference books yet, because they're in the works, you don't have the grammar reference books yet to help you, right? So now, right now, I'm asking you to work intuitively and to start to feel, oh, yeah, you know, just saying, you know, definite, indefinite is not enough, and throwing articles at nouns, right? So where do we need to go with this, right?
Can I add something to that? And then I know there are a couple of hands up, but we talked over here a little bit about this native non-native speaker shutdown that sometimes occurs. And I think that's part of what you're pointing at as well, right? So I'm a native English speaker, if someone gives me this text, I assume I can read this text and I try to figure out what's complicated about the text. But sometimes coming in as a non-native speaker, the first reaction is to say, I can't do this, I'm not at that level, right? And that's that shutdown that you're talking about, I think that we often try to protect our students from. So part of this is to sort of gently throw them into that so that that shutdown doesn't occur outside of the classroom where they don't have our support. So I think part of it is also saying, okay, play, messiness, ambiguity, all of these things are part of language. How do we teach them to ask the right kinds of questions so that they can deal with that when we're also not there, they're supporting them in a sense. I think I could use parenting metaphors for that as well, but kind of riding a bike or something like that where you have to let go at some point. Otherwise, and they might fall over and that's okay, but you learn to like falling over a little bit. Right? So I think that's part of what the approach is. Okay, I know there are a couple of hands up.
I had experience working on a teaching Spanish as a foreign language with the regular curriculum. And at the same time, later on, you know, I jumped into teaching on a full immersion program. It was teaching to English speaking students. Basically, I started with second graders. And I was, you know, I experienced that level of anxiety. How I am going to teach these little kids in a full immersion program because I was required to speak Spanish the whole time, no English. So I saw tears at the beginning of some of the children, but it didn't last very long. I think once they get into the level of comfort, because I think I was anxious because having taught, you know, older students, and I thought, you know, These are things that children or the students learn, you know, when they are in high school. But I think I kind of relaxed once I start seeing that the children are really, you know, it is hard at the beginning, but you know, after a while, it is just second nature to them. And by the time, you know, probably within 2 or 3 months, we were just all enjoying. And it came very natural to them. And I ended up reading El Quijote. And we work a lot on, you know, also creating, you know, some, when we plan our curriculum, the English teachers were involved. So more or less, we work in poetry, which poetry is not done until much later in the regular setting. And it's intimidating. And so the children felt like, they were playing with the language and they were just enjoying it. So I think that experience has lowered my level of anxiety and I feel very comfortable just adventuring and presenting them different things that, you know, we might think they are not ready, but they are really ready.
Right. Not knowing the right answer, not wanting to respond in class because they're afraid of making that step of into the unknown. That's the normal anxiety. So, and at the college level, when face becomes that much more important, right? You should only for some students only participate if you feel that you have something really valuable and et cetera. So, getting students to get past that. And here in this kind of approach, everyone has potentially something to contribute because not only are you working intuitively, you're working creatively, and people can bring in. Things from different knowledge bases and experiences, and it really helps to bring out different strengths that students have. Some are going to be very good with grammar in the traditional sense. Others are going to start noticing things and saying, oh, asking good questions or having intuitions that are going to bring things to an interesting level. So I think thinking about weighing out different types of anxiety and, you know, it's not all one thing all the time, and how can you manage. Yeah.
Each time I try to read it, I cannot get something new as far as literature is concerned because it's not my area. But this is, the last reading, and I just discovered from the pragmatic point of view that the Hemingway is using cataphoric reference rather than anaphoric.
Yes.
So I just try to give us, pronoun or just like this. And
yes.
I have to read to know who are they,
yes.
Which is the opposite way.
That's right.
This is a pragmatic point of view as far as this is
concerned.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Thank you.
And I think that's what you're pointing out, right? It has a very important pragmatic effect on the reader.
Yeah. But it is a literary technique.
Yeah, there are.
So that you begin a story with definite articles and pronouns in order to get your reader to jump into your story, to engage, and to have to mentally piece together what is happening. So that's not new. That's not something that Hemingway did that's unusual. But he does, as far as I'm concerned, that use of articles to then do this temporal shift, I just think is so cool.
We also discussed a grammar terminology as kind of a shutdown for our students, most all of us being secondary teachers. But the thought that I wanted to share is, initially, when you have all this play, this word play keeps showing up, and I'm thinking for the majority of our students, language and play aren't on the same page.
That's right.
However, I think I can say for everyone in this room, words and play go together. I mean, if we didn't love it, we wouldn't be doing this, right? So a lot of our task is getting across to our students that they can play with this and to lighten up and also apply that to ourselves. Because I have to confess, when I saw in lesson two some of that terminology, it was like, I've never seen this word before in my life, and I have a degree, and why don't I know what this means? And, right. And my play went away for a moment.
Yes, that's so, that anxiety that comes in. Yeah.
But getting our students to lighten up and play is a major task that we have, whether we're dealing with secondary or post-secondary, I think.
Yes.
So one thing I think we want to point out, again, is the lesson levels, right? So the intermediate advanced, in my curriculum, this would probably be 6th semester. That's probably beyond high school, honestly. That's probably your very, very best students might test in and start in that class, right? A lot of them will actually be probably a semester or so before that. And so this is the level where they've already done all this once and they're coming back to it. And often in curricula, there's some kind of course, whatever it's called, that has a very deliberate grammar focus. But I think even in those courses, which might be out of the scope of some of what you teach, thinking about play isn't always fun. I know that might be a little controversial. Hopefully it's often fun. And if it's not fun in the first couple of years, we know they give up and they go somewhere else, right? I mean, we want to keep them learning the language and exciting. So play is often fun in the beginning. But play can also be serious. But even when you're doing that kind of grammatical work, keeping play in mind keeps all of these kind of nuances, the ways in which things can not fit into those tidy paradigms a lot of the time, but can actually be subverted in interesting ways, stays in the focus. So we were trying to kind of show, look, this works no matter what level you're starting at, these concepts of play.
Can you just explain again, what do you exactly mean by play? Like some of this, especially lesson number two, if I were looking at that as a college student, like for now, for me, I enjoyed it, right? Because I like all those terms. But as a college student, I might have looked at it like, okay, I'm not playing with this. This is anaphoric, cataphoric, you know, this is not fun.
We use the word play because it gets at that non-conventional, creative, nuanced, metaphorical, those levels of language, which actually comprise the majority of language use, you know, to come back to this notion that rules don't even come close to expressing or describing, explaining what a language can produce. That's just the reality, and that's that wall that we just come up against over and over again. So this is about trying to break through that wall. You can interpret play in a number of ways, but here it really is tied to the notion of the literary, the plasticity of language, and how we can help learners to not only cope with it when they encounter it, whether it's in written form, spoken form, imagistic, etc., because there's also all these cultural dimensions that are brought into it too as foreign language learners, but then also how they can use that knowledge to produce, to express what they want to express, to be empowered to use language in ways that are often far more useful and meaningful than following a strict, you know, syntactic rule. Yeah.
I read the second lesson first, and yes, I looked at the terminology and I thought, ooh, yeah. But then I recognized that through the lesson and the way that it's structured and how you ask students to look at it, they don't necessarily have to understand those terms as they are. If they understand what they're looking at in the text, they're saying, you know, they're looking at, oh, they is used in this way, then they're actually understanding what those concepts mean, even if they're turned off by those terms.
That's right. And they don't have to use those terms.
Mm-hmm. And I think, like you said, I think it empowers students to recognize their capabilities in the language. So then hopefully when they're outside of the classroom, and if they encounter something similar in their second language, they recall this experience and they say, okay, I've seen this before. I was scared by it, but now I'm not going to be turned off by it because I know how to overcome that. And so I think this is a good way to help them continue to be inspired, to be challenged, I think.
It's built into the lessons, right? So that structuring is then ties into how we assess. And those are skills that we're bringing out, trying to articulate so that this can be built into curricular design.
So something I was wanting to mention, and I feel like this is a good moment based on what you said, is that many of you have picked up, and I think rightfully so, how this relates to proficiency-based language teaching, right? That there's an emphasis on meaning-making and on language use and communication. The term authentic text has come up that kind of ties back into that. But I think importantly, that's also a return to attention, I don't know if it's a return, but it's an attention to form as well and to language awareness. And that's a sort of bringing the baby in the bathwater back into the tub kind of approach and saying, language use, making meaning, using language from the beginning all the way through is important, but also this kind of language awareness is important. And in the beginning levels, that language awareness is going to be drawing people's attention to specific things through graphic organizers or manipulating. It's going to be probably free of jargon for the most part, right? And the upper levels, sometimes introducing a meta language, a vocabulary, is a way of refining that kind of attention to language. But I think at all levels, uniting that language use and the attention to language, that focus on form, is really inherent in the approach.
There was an interesting discussion here, which I think we can expand to the whole group, was about Japanese. And the question becomes more broadly, let's listen to Junko talk about what this text might mean to her in Japanese, but then ask you to also think about in the languages that you teach, whether it's specific to this lesson or not, but how you might interpret it to better work with your context and languages.
Okay, so first of all, in our group, the differences, the question we have, first of all, differences, we start from a second one and Chantal's one, and that was just, first of all, the conversation part, right away, so we really have to let the students think, like, okay, what does that mean? Oh, who's saying that? Just like you said on the questions at the end of the first question, conceptualizing. And that gives you, you know, any level, you really have to think creatively. You really have to use the frontal part of the brain to just, you know, think well about that what the story is about. And then I think, you know, we kind of like thought it would be very interesting to start out from that point of view. But also, like before, you know, Chantelle's telling us, you do the first basis before hit to this. So before we knew it, it was kind of like thought, well, maybe difficult for the first level, you know, like beginner level. But again, you know, when I heard that Chantelle said that they're going to do the basis first, in that case, yeah, it will be probably fun to start out from that part of that, you know, literature. Then giving you more information later on, adding on to it, and then at the end, they can create their own, you know, kind of like plot and stuff like that. That's very creative. And then Joanna started more, we thought it was more informative because give you a step-by-step, so easy to follow. And but again, you put creativity as well as researching part of it. So that will give them more like idea of which direction they're supposed to go to. And both of them incorporate a lot of creativity, so as reading skills and then researching skills, using more like internet system, and I think those are the common things that we saw. Now, talking about I taught Japanese, and then unique part of Japanese, we don't have we do have the pronouns, but we don't really put into the sentence a lot. So The Chantelle's first question of that, you know, those six sentences of the conversation, you see a lot on your literature, Japanese literature. So really have to think who's talking, when they're talking, we don't even have a singular, a plural. So you really have to think what they're talking about. And that I can throw into even the beginner level students. A lot of Japanese, students who take Japanese, they like animation. And if you have a chance to see animation, they exactly, if you don't see the picture, if you just put the words coming from the animation, and you don't know who's talking or what are they talking or when they're talking. So I can use that as a text and then put that into my class and then let them start the conversation. And depending on what level of the students, maybe they can start from the very simple conversation for the beginners, or maybe, you know, for the advanced level, they put some more, you know, complex sentences and then let them think. That's what I kind of like thought will be one of the things I can do.
So is it all context dependent, or are there, I imagine there are some linguistic features that trigger if you understand what those the meanings and functions of those features?
If I understand what your question is, I think more like a context. We have to read find the context from the conversation or sentences, what is in the literature most of the time.
Does word order affect meaning?
Sometimes not.
Okay. To bring to the fore any of those signals, those clues, those linguistic features that students are not just, again, based on certain rules, trying to just put in place, but understand what is the meaning of those things and mm-hmm. how, if I change, if it's word order, if I change that word to here, or if I bring in, I know that in Japanese and Korean and Chinese there is all these morphological, they're separate elements, mm-hmm. right? That do a lot of the controlling of grammar,
right?
That are so vast in their right. meanings and uses. Well, that's where you have to bring in that play too.
Right. You know? So on the other hand, if we put one sentence and they can play it around, we can even switch to say the same meaning and same time, same meaning. So we can put them into them and then let them play around as well. So, yeah.
Your mention of anime made me think, and this is going a little bit in a different direction, but with a beginning level class, another strategy would be to use visualization. And again, you have to think about what in the language am I trying to draw their attention to. But I was thinking if you had took off the top of the text and we just had this, they were both beat workers, a Mexican and a Russian, and they were sitting drinking coffee in an all-night restaurant. I don't have time to do this as an experiment, but I'm willing to bet if I had people draw that, you would have drawn men. Probably, right? So even those kinds of more cultural schemas that can come out of visualizing, as well as attention to, well, where, how many when you hear they, right? The things like that can help to direct their attention back to a text at these lower levels where they don't have the mastery of language to maybe discuss that in depth in the language itself.
I'm Korean, and in Korea, I teach Spanish. So maybe my English is not understandable, but what I think comparing two lessons, the first one is more gentle, kinder, but the second one is more intriguing, more challenging. I started with the second lesson, and I felt the geniusness of Hemingway. It helps me discover the genius of Hemingway because I've learned a lot about the article systems and pronoun systems, but I didn't know that somebody can play with these systems, grammatical systems. But with the first lesson, every explanation is step by step. So I can understand everything, but I cannot feel the genius, Hemingway's geniusness. So it's more interesting the second lesson, but it's not very recommendable for Korean students who learn English because it's very high level of reference play. So it's really difficult to catch the idea, no? So if you treat with the Asian students, maybe the first kind of lesson is more recommendable. And if you treat with the Spanish speakers, they have article systems. So with the second lesson, they can be feel more challenged finding out the Hemingway's geniusness. After that, if I can explain my explanation about article systems in Western languages and their absenceness in Asian languages, what happens is that Westerners give more attention to the individuality of the object and persons. So you have to mark the identity of all object and all persons. So you use article systems. But Asians give more attention to the relationship between the persons and object. So we have other systems to mark social relationships between persons. So it's a little different. We perceive the same things, but we focus on different things.
Well, I misunderstood actually from the beginning what we should do, but finally I got it, maybe because I came somewhat late. But you said that it's better to compare the two lessons. What I noticed from the, let's say, from the audience notes, that here they followed the whole approach. We have the same questions in reading task and the same questions, but with reading tasks. And this make the students be aware about language, but with enjoying the literary that they have. For example, here we have some questions about what does this mean, who are they, them, and who are the characters are. And then in the written part, we have some question about the pronouns and write maybe a paragraph or some sentences to refer to these pronouns. So here we have the relation between, actually you found the relation very cleverly, how to link reading and writing. And in this way, we actually improve the student's level of expression. Read and then write. Yeah, and the theme is one theme, which is the Hemingway story.
I want to flag two things because I know we want to come back to them this afternoon and that have come up several times in comparing the two lessons that are at different levels. And what is this question of scaffolding, right? How do you scaffold at different levels? What kind of support do they need? What kind of resources do they have? And then also a question that I think we haven't called it that, but we've been talking about different objectives, right? In a beginning level class, a more late beginner class, your objectives are likely going to be different. Your learning goals are going to be different than what you're doing at a more advanced course where they're probably reviewing a lot of these concepts and expanding on that kind of knowledge. So we've hit on those really well and comparing them. What about the question, now we've switched slides, but the question about taking these two lessons, not as a comparison, how are they different, but what do they have in common in comparison to maybe other kinds of lessons that you've encountered in working with texts? And moving more in that direction.
There's integration between them. We cannot separate them. Yeah. The aim is to help the student to get the language with, let's say, doing reading and writing. Yeah, we can say it's task-based. Yeah, and with task-based, this, let's say, keep transferring the information from the, let's say, temporary memory to the long-term memory. They can remember. And I think these lessons are, let's say, related to each other. Maybe, at the beginning level, we want to measure the student knowledge, understanding, and then we have to make them apply, analyze, and synthesize, and sometimes we have to ask them, let's say, some of kind of high-level thinking questions. They might evaluate, they might create, they might, as you said, we give them the, let's say, part of the stories, and they have to link them together. They might change or, let's say, reinstruct the events together. But they, at the same time, they have to think about the grammar tenses, the words that they can get, where and when, who and what.